sir. So, in fact, I think we're going to get started right about now. It's nine. Well, boom, 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 boom. Check and make sure. Press one if you see it. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, 10, 11, 12. And they all came down to the ladybug's picnic. One, two, three, four, five, six. And we're off. It is 9:01 a.m. U.S. Pacific Standard Time here in Los Angeles. Tuesday, the 20th of February, A.D. 2024. Had a great show yesterday, in my opinion. I had fun with it anyway. With Big Bump, B-I-G-G, new word, B-U-M-P. And there was one topic I didn't cover. I was remiss in not covering it with him, this persecution of the president, our greatest president, Trump. So I hope to touch on that today, okay? Is that okay with you? I think it's fine with you guys. What else? Space is real, guys. The Earth is plainly a ball. I am showing my Flat Earth Society. I pulled it down off of the wall here. Sean had installed it, and it's going to be tricky for me to put it back up. But I can handle tricky things. Yes, I'm an honorary Flat Earth Society member for my tireless promotion of the Flat Earth. Even though I'm a ball-tard for life. Indeed. I play the Big Bump replays to help me fall asleep at night, Hake, says Nugget Man, because he has a soothing voice, a la Dr. Ben Carson's son. Does Dr. Ben Carson have any children? What else will we touch on? I hope to touch on my VP pick, by the way. I have a playful but real vice president pick for Trump 2024, of course. Some of you guys aren't voting. Whatever. Fani Willis, interesting gal, calls to get to. And you guys ever heard of Basquiat? I may play a clip or two of Basquiat, who was this black New York artist back in the day, and he died. Rest in peace. So hopefully all of that and your calls, some of you guys are already on hold if you'd like to call in. Beautiful music to share. Steve Taylor Tuesday. And it's Black History Month Shuby Taylor Tuesday. Nice. But anyway, guys, let's get right on with the show!
One, two, three, four. Oh, it's the Hake Report. The Hake Report. La, la, la.
How you guys doing? I am fine. I have my Yellowstone t-shirt on. You can barely see it because I have this Flat Earth Society thing in the way. The wonder of Yellowstone. Is that the one that's in Wyoming or something? I don't know. Where's Yellowstone? Am I embarrassing myself? What a mess. Yeah, I won't tell you where I got it. It's just kind of not your business where I got this t-shirt, which should tell you something about it. Let me see if I can stream live on IG. I'm not quite used to this, guys, so bear with me. I want to stream on IG, Instagram, the Hake Report Instagram. So neglected. Poor Instagram. They're even more redheaded stepchildren-ish than DLive, than the DLive crew. The real ones who actually kind of support Hake. What a mess. Nice. We're live on IG, I think. So let me get to a call or two, guys. Mark in Los Angeles, California, before we get into the stories. Mark, thanks for calling. What's up,
man? Thank you for taking the call. I I don't have a lot of time, so I'll get this out.
Cool.
I just got a stat that you may want to, your audience may be interested in. From the FBI, per 100,000 people in the U.S., 22.2 black people kill out of that 100,000. It's 22.2 out of, for every 100,000 people are murdered by Negroes. For whites, per 100,000, it's 2.2.
Yeah, it's about 10 times as much.
Yeah, 10 times as much. That's actually an FBI stat that Mark Dice showed on his show this morning.
Yeah, and Dice is, he gets the facts right. He used to be a little more conspiracy-minded, but yeah.
No, but he actually showed
a fellow fan of Jesse Lee Peterson, by the way.
Oh, he's a fan?
Yeah. Yeah, he appreciates JLP.
Cool. Yeah. And there was something else about this. Okay. He Googled it. I don't know what it's called. I'm not familiar, but it's a thing where you could ask questions, you know, about different subjects to Google. And Mark Dice Googled the, you know, black versus white murder rates in the U.S. And before they gave him that stat, oh God, he read what they said to him. Well, you have to consider the environment, all these fake excuses.
Right.
For black
Yeah. Savagery. Context needed. Or liars like, well, I won't bring up the guy. Well, I already brought him up. Liars like the guy your nemesis, who pretend like the facts, like the truth is not the truth. And you have to you have to say it in a specific way, otherwise it's a lie. Stupid.
Well, you're talking about Fani Willis' son, right? The guy from Phoenix?
That's right.
His son?
Yeah.
Yeah, I figured it would be. He was the only guy that I heard on your show, I think it was last week when Jesse, I did see that, where he talked about that witch from Fulton County.
Ah. Oh, really?
Fani Willis. It was on Facebook Shorts.
Okay.
And this clown that calls in from Phoenix, you know, he sounds like his mom. It's got to be Fani Willis, but whatever. He was the only one that defended her on your show. And one other thing real quick, I know I don't mean to jump around, but I'm going to be going in a minute. The three-judge panel that said Trump didn't have immunity, if you read what they wrote to deny him his constitutional rights, it was garbage. A three-year-old could have wrote it. All they did was use hypotheticals.
Yeah.
Well, would he have immunity if he killed somebody? I mean, all these it had nothing to do.
Right.
The questions that these communist judges asked him had nothing to do with real presidential immunity. I'm talking about Trump's lawyers.
Makes sense.
I'm hoping and praying if he wins the immunity case at the Supreme Court level, that'll throw Jack Smith's case out where it belongs. And it looks like Fani Willis down there is going to blow the case, hopefully, against Trump in Atlanta, but we don't know. But I do believe Trump is a gift from God, and I think that he will win, despite the Biden administration and their cohorts. These DAs that are Soros-backed, they're not going to win. I just believe it in my heart. Trump has got God on his side, and I think we're going to win this.
Nice, man. That's cool. I don't know if you heard my call with the guy who accused me and you of Trump worship, but I'm with you. I think that he is, as you said, a gift from God, the light of the world, as Jesus called his disciples.
How many men could take the pressure that President Trump is under?
Yeah.
From Satan's children. These are, if you can't see the devil in Fani Willis, you're as evil as she is.
Yeah.
And those are the kind of people that are breeding children and that are teaching their children to hate the white man.
Right. That's why you understand. That's why we should show understanding to the blacks, because they were raised, and as Oprah said about whites, the blacks were born and bred and marinated in this anti-whiteness. They really are just blind and can't see. So
I don't see how that's ever going to change. I hope it does. It's unlikely that it will. Hating whitey has been something the blacks have been preaching since I've been alive.
And you brought up Fani. You let me briefly interrupt. You brought up Fani Willis, and you saw how she broke under pressure. She thought that she was standing up tough. And
right.
Trump has never acted that way under far, far, far more endless pressure and attacks than Fani Willis could even dream. So, yeah, you're right. Trump is solid. Well, I interrupted you about the black. Go ahead.
No, I was just going to say, in regards to Fani Willis, the fact that she broke under pressure is a way of showing her low IQ.
Yeah.
I mean, she's a very low IQ person. She's filled with hate for the white man, and fellow white haters voted her in. I don't know what is Fulton County, Atlanta? I guess it is.
Yeah, that's Atlanta.
Okay, that's a lost cause.
Yeah.
Go to Atlanta and walk the streets at night and see how nice it is. And that used to be a great city at one time.
Yeah. JLP was going to live there, I think. And then he went to Los Angeles and loved Los Angeles and stayed. I think he was glad to stay in Los Angeles, even as bad as L.A. is now.
Well, there are some good suburbs around Atlanta that are livable. But the downtown area has been lost to the devil. So.
Right.
Yeah, yep. I could see how she could win elections. It's too bad. But I'm standing with Trump all the way to the end.
Nice, man. I appreciate it. It's good to hear from you, Mark, in Los Angeles.
Thank you, sir. Have a good day.
All right. Bye. What's up, Ashley, over in the Facebook crew? I got Hake's Facebook working again. I'm kind of a boomer. Boomer tech. What a mess. So what's Hake's VP pick? You guys have called in over the past couple weeks, I guess, giving me your lame-o normie VP picks. Kari Lake. Ben Carson. No, I don't know if anybody picked him, really. Tucker Carlson. He would be okay. Alan West. I don't know if anybody mentioned him. Who else did you guys bring to me? Oh, Vivek Ramaswamy. He's not even a normal American white Anglo-Christian. He's a good performer. Anyway. I like him, though. I do like him. But not for that. I keep on saying press secretary for him. Because it's sort of a dismissive job, and yet it's also, he handles the media very well. And I like that. And he's actually really smart. But he's just not, he's not American. In spirit, maybe he's somewhat more American. You know, he kind of loves white people, I think, maybe. Or at least he pretends to. I appreciate that. Hey, at least pretend. Who else do you guys think about for president? There were some other ones who were good. Oh, DeSantis, I guess nobody really picks him anymore because DeSantis sort of turned on Trump, acted all tough, and listened to his wife or something, or these liberal, never-Trumpers. Somebody picked the guy, the wheelchair-bound relative rhino from Texas. I call him a rhino, but he may not be as bad as I'm saying. Somebody suggested Mike Flynn in the chat just now. I like that idea. I haven't really heard Mike Flynn speak. My pick... Am I ready? Is there any others? are there any others? Who else? Do you remember any of the other names, Hassan, that were floated for vice president? That were, somebody said Kristi Noem. Come on. Sarah Palin is Hassan's prediction. Not that would be his pick. That wouldn't be Hassan's favorite, I don't think. Trump, JLP probably wants Putin. Sean says, Sean reminds me, Al from somewhere said Byron Donalds. Yeah, that was sort of interesting. I don't hate him. It's just that he's black and young. And being black and young, untested, it feels like kiss up. Even though Al from, my black conservative caller made some nice points. But who else? Anybody else? Was there anybody else who was interesting, exciting? I don't remember. How about Mike Pence? Barron Trump. He's tall enough. Tulsi Gabbard. So anyway, some of you guys have probably tuned out and gotten annoyed at Hake for not bringing it. My pick? Azzmador. Azzmador, Trump. Trump as 2024. Our resident historian, Azzmador. Reason I say that is because, oh yeah, somebody said Larry Elder. Thank you, Thomas Helder, Hammer, in the chat. Larry Elder. And I like Larry Elder. I just don't like him for vice president. Although Larry Elder would do it, and he would probably do a great job. But I don't think Trump would pick him. And he, too, is somewhat untested. Even though he's in his 70s, he seems young, I guess. That's kind of messed up to say, because he's like the perfect age. At the tail end of the perfect age, honestly. But I don't think, I just don't see it. That's also another, because he's black. And I don't like this kissing up, this diversity kissing up thing. But Azzmador sounds like a man. Loyal, like a man. Clear thinking. Knows his stuff. And he's a, either that or Secretary of War. Or no. Not Secretary. We're going to abolish all the secretaries in the Trump administration 2024. He's going to be the man of war. And yet he will be a man of peace alongside Trump. Isn't that cool? Dog the bounty hunter. So that's my pick. I don't think that Trump will do it, and it may not be his time. So that's fine. That's fine. Maybe in 10 or 20 years. But that would be one that I would be like, okay, thumbs up. Nobody else that I've heard do I like, but I'll still vote for Trump, pretty much. Because Trump is just solid. He's real. He's genuine. I heard this guy say that Trump is authentic. This fighter guy, Sean Strickland. He did this sit down in his bathrobe, drinking a coffee with the Don't Tread on Me Gadsden flag style mug of coffee, I guess it was. I hope it was coffee. And he was sitting around talking about how he beat up Sneeko, and he faced off with Trump, and he said, you know what, I normally face off with somebody or square up with somebody, even in a pretend setting, and I want to kill the guy because he's really angry and violent. Sean Strickland, he's a UFC fighter. You guys know probably better than I do. Mike Tyson for VP. He's too nice, though, and black. But it doesn't feel as much of a kiss-up thing for some reason. But he said that Trump is authentic. Everybody says that, who has ever met him. And some of us can plainly see, and some of you guys plainly can't see, that he's an authentic, real guy. FYI. So I just wanted to point that out. David in Kansas is on the line. David in Kansas, how are you doing, man?
I'm all right, Hake. How are you?
I'm fine, thank you.
I heard you mention Carrie Lake again. Yeah, that was me. I called you a few weeks ago and mentioned her. And
are you the one who
back about Larry Elder?
You're back about Larry Elder? Are you the one who sparked this whole thing? Because it wasn't even really a topic of my show, and then you sparked all these calls about their favorite pick for Trump VP, living in our imaginations.
Yep. Well, I tell you what. Okay. I originally said Carrie Lake, and then I called you a week later about Larry Elder. Well, after some thinking, I know who Trump will pick. I know this for a fact. Okay, no, I don't. It's not a fact, but I'm pretty sure. Trump will pick Rand Paul.
Oh, wow.
And I would love to see Trump pick Rand Paul. Larry Elder, I agree with you. That would be fantastic, but that's so unrealistic.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah. Because he's not in...
Rand Paul is realistic.
That's interesting. But can't Rand Paul do better as a senator? A lot of these suggestions, Rand Paul is a senator, right, from Kentucky? I'd rather I'd rather have him stay as a senator and be useful there, maybe. I kind of like Rand Paul. He's hit and miss, but I do like him.
He's a pretty incredible person when it comes to his who he is and what he does. I'll tell you, I don't know a terrible lot about his political past, but everything I see about Rand Paul since 2016 has been pretty cool.
Yeah.
And, you know, like you were saying earlier, we love Trump because he's a good man. And when I talked to you last time, you had I loved your response. You said, I choose Trump because of the man, not his policies.
Right.
I love that. That's a great answer.
Yeah, because he's a genuine guy. And I'd rather have a genuine guy than a phony politician. And the stuff that I disagree with, it's not so much of a big deal because the policies aren't as important as the spirit. Because the spirit is the evil spirit that possesses everybody is destroying America. And I get that America is going to continue to probably go downhill because one man's probably not going to turn anything around. But he'll help awaken some people as he's already done. And that's all I'm looking for.
One thing, and I don't know if Jesse still says this, but Jesse used to say, "My country is gone."
Yeah.
Well, the old country is gone. But I believe America at its core, we are still the good guys. We are still the center of, I believe, hope, you know, and I believe that good American spirit is still here. It's just got an evil cloud over it right now, but we're still here, brother. Guys like you and me and a lot of your callers, you know, we're still here.
Right. I don't know if what you mean by we, who are we that's the good guys?
Oh, well, I guess patriots, God-fearing men, I don't know. Guard, I guess.
I know that in every country, or I believe that in maybe not every country, but maybe every country, there are points of light. There are people who are about the truth and are living it. But I don't know if America's. I don't know. I'm not sure if I agree with you.
Well, it's not done. I love Jesse. I agree with 90% of the things he said. And one of the things I think Jesse will realize is, you know, we still have hope. You know, it's still here. America's still here.
Yeah.
It's.
I mean, I'm still here. You're still here, somewhat. That much is true.
Yeah. Well, thank you, Hake. I love your show. I enjoy listening to it, brother. I'm on the highway, so I got to get back to it.
Right on, man. Appreciate it, David in Kansas. Take care.
Take care, brother.
Bye. I missed a super chat or two yesterday, by the way, guys. I will get to those. William in California is on the line. William, thank you for calling, man. How you doing?
Hey, what's going on, man?
Hey, going well. You're coming in kind of rough.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I can barely hear you. Stay close to the phone.
Okay. Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Okay. I want to pick somebody as far as VP. It's got to be somebody that you want to see in office 4 years later.
You know, I don't think that you are loud enough. I don't know if somebody can get in here and turn them up.
You know, wait a minute. How about now?
Yeah, stay close to the phone and speak up loud and clear.
Okay. As far as a VP, I would like to stick to somebody that we would want to see after Trump leaves.
Oh.
That's what my strategy would be.
That'd be nice, because Reagan didn't do that for us. He gave us Bush, and I thought Bush was like Reagan, because that was what my second grade teacher told me. So I told my mother to vote for Bush. I didn't even know about women voting back then.
They still got 12 years, though. They got 12 years, though. Yeah.
Huh. What do you mean by that?
I would say, I mean, do you have to pick a woman?
No, please no. But I still vote for him.
If I did, I would pick Condoleezza Rice,
Carol
Swain, or Sarah Palin.
I would not go with Condoleezza Rice. She is a feminist.
Yeah, she is.
Yeah, she's into the black thing. Or something. There was something about her that's gone real.
Probably the woman thing. Probably.
Yeah. Him up. Turn him up. If you can. He's coming in.
She's not the worst, though.
No, she's not the worst. But why even go there? Well, thankfully, Trump is not going to do that.
Right. Yeah. Right.
She's hopefully had her trans.
Pick a woman. Carol Swain. I like her, but I think I would put her. What's the title for the education?
Yeah, Secretary of Education. And then shut it down, there. And then shut down the Department of Education.
yeah, take it away.
Yeah, because it doesn't belong. Union. Reagan was supposed to get rid of the Department of Education, but he didn't get around to it.
I don't think he had the House at the time.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, maybe. I don't know. I'd have to check and see if he did. That's probably what stopped him.
Okay.
Yeah. Sarah Palin's not bad either.
Right. I liked her back. People blamed her for McCain losing. I doubt that. I think McCain is to blame for McCain losing. I really liked Sarah Palin. She would kind of speak in catchy terms that she heard on the internet, it seemed like. Maybe, or maybe she's the one who came up with them. But I think that she's trying to be a leader, and her family's become kind of a mess. She reminds me in that way somewhat of Marjorie Greene. Like, they just need to tend to their families and just be ladies.
Right.
And I like them both.
A strong woman, you know, she tries to put that on,
Yeah.
She does that.
And her husband didn't used to seem like beta, but apparently he kind of was.
He is now. Yeah, he is now. Yeah, that's all I wanted, man.
Nice.
The other stuff, there's no need of reporting anything what the blacks are doing. They're just messing up every day.
Yeah, it's crazy.
And I told you, you don't put them in charge of cities, counties, churches, businesses. I told you that.
Yeah,
you Fani did?
I have some Fani stuff to cover.
And the other one, and it will be appealed, the $300-something million, that will be appealed.
Okay. Yeah, that was something that I wanted to touch on. Big Bump wanted to cover it yesterday. We didn't get to it, but I'm going to get to that shortly here.
Well, I'm pretty sure they will.
We'll see what happens.
Right, right. Okay, you guys have a good one.
All right, you as well. Take care, buddy.
All right.
Bye. Okay. So this is from Big Bump. He co-hosted with me yesterday, President's Day, Washington's birthday. Trump is looking out for New York. I don't know if that was the point that Big Bump was bringing. He co-hosts with me on sometimes. This is a Rolling Stone article headline sent to us from the great Big Bump. Trump says $355 million fraud penalty. Fraud penalty. Far-left extremist Rolling Stone. They've had to retract stories before. Fake rape on campus story, for example. They're far-left liberals, feminists, not Christians. The GOP frontrunner took his perch at Mar-a-Lago. That's his house in Florida. After the ruling and vowed to appeal it, as William, my caller, just earlier this hour stated. It's an article by Charisma something or other. Charisma something or other. Matarang. Out February 16th, Friday, I guess. 2024 AD. Trump speaking before, during a break in his civil fraud trial in New York. Civil fraud trial, meaning this is not felony stuff. Maybe it's a setup to try to charge them with a felony afterwards after they do all this mumbo-jumbo shenanigans. That's Engoron and the big black female gal, which is redundant. Letitia James, no relation to Hake, James Hake. Black female attorney general of New York. New York, so corrupt. And then they're trying to get rid of their best guy. The best New York-born man. What a shame. They don't know what's good for them. So he said that it's going to destroy the state of New York. What does he mean by that? Clip 11 I have here, Hassan. ACYN posted this on X, Twitter. Trump claims New York State will be gone. And that's a quote, gone. If his appeal is not successful because people will move out. Maybe businesses. 22 seconds. Here it is.
And they want me out. Oh, let's see if we can get them out. These are radical left Democrats. They're lunatics. And it's election interfering. So I just want to thank you for being here.
Nice.
We'll appeal. We'll be successful, I think, because, frankly, if we're not successful, New York State is gone. People are moving out of New York State. And because of this, they're going to move out at a much faster rate.
That's true. People are moving from New York to Florida and corrupting Florida because they're taking their dumb liberal values that destroyed New York down to, Florida. All these people fleeing California for Idaho and Tejas, Texas, turning those states corrupt and nasty, bringing Antifa with them. Antifa! So they are leaving New York, aren't they? Yeah, and then businesses don't want to do stuff. I saw this headline from Commie Nonsense Network, of all places, from CNN.com. You know I check it every morning. Saying Kevin O'Leary. Remember that guy from Shark Tank? I don't even know if he's Christian or not. Supposedly a white guy. It's him, and then that black guy, and then the Mark Cuban fellow. Kevin O'Leary has said some, you know, good things about the economy, because he's somewhat sensible on the economy. And maybe other things. He's like a boomer. Said what Trump did was normal for every business. If I understood the headline correctly. I may be misstating his meaning. But what Trump did in terms of supposedly inflating his value of Mar-a-Lago to get a nicer loan rate, and no dollars were lost, I heard. I heard on the JLP show that Elon Musk, fellow based billionaire alongside our greatest president Trump, said if no money was lost, if there were no victims of this so-called fraud, and the, as Scott Adams says, the banks never take the guy at his word in terms of how he values any person, by when I say guy, value their assets, their properties, and all these things. They call it a difference of opinion, not fraud. So it's a phony, trumped-up charge, according to these normal people who are sensible, not these people with a bone to pick to pretend that Trump is some criminal. Give me a break. I'm thinking about you, some of you callers who are Trump haters. I don't hate Trump, they claim. What a mess. What a mess. So that's our greatest president looking out for New York. Not even concerned about himself. Because what's 355 million to a billionaire? I mean, they're trying to chip away at everything they can. Trying to bury my competitor, Alex Jones. My competitor. I'm behind it, by the way. I'm like, yes, take him out. just kidding. I can handle the competition. I don't need him to be handicapped, kneecapped, or whatever. But they're going after the best people in America, these phonies. There's a phony named John Foreigner, this Foreigner guy. John, what's the guy's name? Where did I put it? I wonder if I have it. Darkness hates the light. Here it is. I didn't recognize it because I put some poetic thing on it. The darkness hates the light. Here's a quote to prove it. We are prepared to offer you $1 million a year for the rest of your life. If you agree to simply leave, he split his infinitive in proper English from this Englishman, the Supreme Court immediately, That's a quote shared by Commie Nonsense Network. I read them, my fault. The far-left foreign comedian, John Oliver, presenting our greatest and our one true justice, Clarence Thomas, with an unconventional offer of $1 million a year to resign from the so-called Supreme Court. He's the only one giving any legitimacy to the Supreme Court. Him and maybe that other guy. Who didn't get killed or die or whatever. Not Scalia, but Scalise? Steve Scalise? No, not Scalise. I forget. Who's the other guy? Evil John Oliver is one of the many foreigner. He has like this British accent. Last week tonight with John Oliver, something like that. He's one of many phony liberal late night hosts, according to Commie Nonsense Network, using their spotlight to skewer the best people on the high court. And the few lights in the dark place called America's political landscape. Justice Thomas, his wife Ginny Thomas, two solid people, Ginny and Justice Clarence Thomas, friends of JLP, by the way. Ginny, G-I-N-N-I, I think it's short for Virginia. A white woman, a gal. She is somewhat into politics. I'm not familiar with her. But, you know, she's just trying to do right in the country that's in a place that's so dark, evil. You are no competition for Alex Jones, LOL, says Scarecrow's Garage. Baby steps, baby, baby steps. You are 1% on Alex Jones's level. Really? 1%? You think so? You think it's 1%? I'm all excited. These psychos love to attack the law. Yeah, Trump, law and order. So you're saying there's a chance. More like 1/1,000,000. Justice Thomas is about actual justice. As far as I've ever seen, solid guy, unshakable. Trump, he's about law and order, loves the country. There's no question. Pushing for what's right as the best any boomer can. Besides, I don't know, is Ron Paul boomer? I'm not sure. But Trump is actually successful. Ron Paul was not. Shout out to Ron Paul and his supporters. James Antonin Hake, Antonin Scalia. He was Italian, but he was also for real justice. They found a pillow over his head, but was it like suffocation type pillow or was it up above or what? How did he die? Seemed suspicious, but don't know really. Also could have been not suspicious. So that's the darkness hating the light. Phony guy. We're prepared to offer you $1 million a year for the rest of your life. He doesn't probably couldn't afford that. Not funny, John Oliver. Lame-o. He's the guy who wears glasses. Horn-rimmed glasses or something, you know, like dark frames and has sort of dark brown hair. Probably not a Christian. Some of those late-night hosts purport to be Christians. Did you know that? Stephen Colbert. He thinks he's a Christian, I think. Isn't that nice? But they're dumb liberals. Can you blame them? They grew up in that world. Or their job depends on them playing by the liberal false values of hating people who stand for what's right, like Thomas. And Thomas has been smeared for being friends with this billionaire guy who took him on trips and subsidized his grandson's or granddaughter's or somebody, nephew, something like that, college education. Like, that's going to change how Thomas, and this guy's a man, this billionaire is a man who loves historians. Thomas isn't going to be swayed by that. He supports Thomas because he appreciates Thomas. Hey, how do you make boys first? Quadruple question mark. You care too much. That's a beta. Automatic girl first, Sal. Al is in Tennessee, who's on the line. I mentioned Al, and it was in from Tennessee. Al, thanks for calling, man. What's up?
Hey, hey, how's it going?
Going well.
I just wanted to
Yeah.
I wanted to address that gentleman that just called about the statistics, and also the vice president presidential pick. With the statistics, it's kind of unfair to run around quoting statistics about blacks and whites because it's absurd. You already know that if you're trying to compare a bigger number with a smaller number, smaller number is always going to come up with higher statistics. So it's silly. If we're going to address the fact that crime is high in black communities, that's a fact. We don't have to sit there and play shamey with bogus statistics. We understand that the black community is where people don't want to move. People don't invest. The out of wedlock birth is high. We understand that it's nothing but a cesspool of debauchery.
Yeah.
So what as far as politicians, if you wanted as a Republican to sway black voters, you can just put out your agenda of we are pro-family, we are pro-morals, and show what you mean and say, hey, we are pro-family because those things matter. And it will help you and give statistics on how families help, you know, communities to thrive and become more successful. But just running out quoting statistics and saying, oh, shame on you, you turn people off. And you're basically, you know, it's more of a pride thing to sit there and say, oh, yeah, you know, blacks commit more crime than whites. Well, if their numbers were equal, you probably get a different result. But it's neither here nor there, because if you enter into a black community, you don't feel safe.
Right.
As opposed to entering into a white community. But as far as the presidential vice president, I would say Donald Trump is of the fabric of the founding fathers. The founding fathers were plantation owners. They were farmers. They had businesses. They were some of them were wealthy, and they had a stake in the country. When you have a person who isn't a business owner, who isn't wealthy, someone who doesn't have a stake in the country, they have to pander to get funds. Donald Trump is a builder. He sees America for what it is. He's not someone living a fantasy or living through the eyes of the donors.
Yeah.
He says, I build in this country. I understand what it needs. I know what it takes to build.
Yeah.
And this is why he's successful. We need to stop looking at these people like a Bernie Sanders who's never produced anything, or like a Bill Clinton who never owned or produced anything. They know how to swindle, but they don't know how to build. And same with Barack Obama. He knew how to speak, but he didn't know how to build. This is why they're not successful.
Yeah.
And when you have people who actually have a stake in the country and say, hey, I know what makes this country run, and I can keep it running, and I know the right things to do to make us successful, those are the people we should be looking for. Instead of the guys who come out with the pretty words, you know, like Hillary Clinton, and saying stupid things,
yeah.
Say, hey, what have you produced?
That's so true,
and that
man.
Is who the next, that's who the next vice president should be.
Somebody who's also a builder, huh?
Yes.
You know.
And that may be.
Go
that
ahead.
May be Vivek.
Uh-huh.
That may be Vivek. I know you don't like him. And
vice president, but continue.
And I say, being that his family is foreign, he's first generation, I tend to, you know, question loyalties. I think he says the right thing. I think he has a good plan. It's similar to Trump's, but maybe that's a ruse. But I like the guy. Unless you said, hey, there was someone like Bloomberg, but Bloomberg is a liberal. He's
yeah.
a builder, yes. But the guy can't be trusted.
Right.
I think Trump is not necessarily conservative, but he is pro-America.
Yep.
And that's what his appeal is.
Yeah, totally. I don't even care about the conservative liberal thing.
Yeah.
You made a great point about these phony politicians versus Trump. Another contrast, I mentioned earlier this hour that I watched this little sit-down coffee talk edited and put out by Sean Strickland, this UFC fighter, who's kind of controversial.
Yeah.
He said that he also likes Trump, and he didn't even necessarily wouldn't vote for him or didn't vote for him for the primary or didn't say, But if Trump wins in the primary, it's for Trump 2024. Because Trump is for solutions and everybody being together. We're all Americans. Whereas with Biden, it's black versus white. Blacks trying to get out from under the whites. Victimhood and division and stuff. And that is another contrast. Trump will talk about stuff that people are doing wrong and do injustices, but it's never this victim mentality or defeatist or hatred. It's coming up with solutions, working with people, even with people whom we don't necessarily like. He has to work with them if he wants to get something done. That's true.
But the thing with black people is that I think they're being judged too harshly. I think the Democrat Party has never let go of black people. After slavery, you had Reconstruction. They've reversed it, and they created Jim Crow laws. They created the vagrancy laws, which if you were put in jail, someone could bail you out. Now you're indebted to those people.
Mm-hmm.
And you have people creating, you know, the separate but equal, the Jim Crow laws. And so basically you had black people constantly under the thumb of Democrats, or Democrats constantly chasing their blacks. And with Margaret Sanger, she proposed using black ministers to keep black people under the thumb and to say, convince them that abortion is okay. And lo and behold, you have other ministers like Martin Luther King, Jesse Jackson, Reverend Al Sharpton, convincing black people that they are victims.
Yeah, right.
So you never get off the plantation. Your mindset is constantly, I'm a victim, I'm a victim. People are looking at black people saying, you're not victims. But it's hard to convince you people that they're not victims when the people they believe in
right.
are telling them they're victims.
Right.
So I think black people are telling, people are looking at black people saying, what the hell is wrong with you?
Yeah.
And they're saying, what the heck is wrong with you? Because I'm a victim. You can't convince me that I'm not.
Yeah. Yeah.
So it's like, unless you tell people, unless you can prove to people you have opportunity, they're going to constantly believe that they are victims.
Yeah.
And we don't have anyone that's out here saying, hey, you know what? Like a Ben Carson or Clarence Thomas, who can come out, because the Democrats will demonize those people. They're successful. They're people you should look up to, but they're all Uncle Toms.
I know.
If you're a successful conservative, you're an Uncle Tom.
Right.
But if you're a drug dealer, you're a hero. If you're a pimp, you're a hero. If you're an athlete, you're a hero. If you're a neuroscientist, you're an Uncle Tom.
Right. Ben Carson, just because he appreciates Trump and told Obama Obamacare was a mess to his face.
Yeah.
Yeah. So when you're saying blacks are judged too harshly, you're talking about by people like our side, it gets easy to lose patience with these blacks who they just can't see. As JLP says, don't judge them. They can't see.
Exactly.
Yeah.
They can't see it because they're so close to the victimhood.
Right.
They can't see it. So no amount of criticism is going to help them. It's only going to push them further into the plantation.
Some criticism is worth it if it's in the right spirit and the person, and a few will see that it's that they're right, you know? Because JLP, criticizes the blacks all the time, but he brings a solution, too. Let go of anger. Yeah. Return to your fathers.
I agree.
Yeah.
And I always ask people, I said, did you wake up this morning? They said, yes. I said, did you go outside? Yes. Was someone burning a cross on your lawn? No. Did right. you go to work? Yes. Did someone stop you? Yes. Do you have a job? Yes. Did someone discriminate and not hire you because you're black? No. So tell me where you're discriminated.
Right.
Did you choose to work that job?
Yep.
Did you choose that school? There's no discrimination but in your head. And when you break it down to people, then they slowly realize, hey, maybe I'm wrong.
Yeah.
And maybe I should see it the other way.
And there's so many, it's human nature to make assumptions from your imagination. When you see somebody do something that seems strange to you, you jump to conclusions about what their motive is and everything. So you make up this, oh, so much racism, the way that they're looking at me.
Yeah.
And everybody falls for this type of thing. People think that Trump is owned by this or that group because he works with them and and caters to them more than they would. And that's not a sign of ownership. It's just a sign of working with them more than you would prefer that he did. So it's the same thing. It, people are blindly judging, and they're no different from the blacks whom they're judging. It's true, man.
This is true. This is true. But this one last thing, we create our reality, and as black people, they create their realities by condoning criminals like George Floyd and putting them on pedestals. And when you're out and about and you go into another neighborhood and they keep their eyes on you or they're thinking that you're stealing, well, you thank that person that came before you and committed crime for creating the environment that you have to enter.
Yeah.
So you're not free from the people that look like you.
Right. The good have to suffer
wrong,
with the bad. Yeah,
exactly.
I've heard over and over, coming to Bond, black guys who don't violently rob people. They may steal, sneaky steal, but they don't like assault people, at least not yet. They get mad getting profiled and people getting all cautious about them. And so what people need who are upset at the blacks or at the whites, at the suspicion and all that stuff, is understanding. Just like understand that I'm not a criminal, but I understand that a whole lot of blacks are committing crimes. And so I understand if you're a little overcautious around me. And
yes.
And you don't have to say that, but just pause and don't go with these thoughts and emotions of even when you're suffering an injustice.
Yes, exactly. You know, and it's funny, you have to create racism for racism to exist. You know, and it's always
right.
Some poor white guy that's living in a trailer with a Confederate flag. And I always ask, I said, how is that white guy in a trailer park affecting your life?
I know.
He can't even control his own life.
Yeah. True.
You know, it's absurd. It's absurd.
Yeah, they make it so. These people who are spreading this division and spreading this racism narrative between blacks and whites and coming up with these hate crimes legislation and anti-discrimination laws, they're causing the problems that they're pretending to want to solve. They're causing people to be suspicious of each other and blame each other because they're getting rewarded for these things. And both sides are getting thrills.
Yes, it pays.
Yeah.
But also, conversely, those poor whites run around saying that people are taking from them. And also, claim that they like to quote those statistics that I brought up before. And they say, well, you know, we built this country.
I know.
No, you didn't.
Right.
You didn't build this country because it was the productive whites that built this country, not the poor whites.
Right.
And I think we have to make that distinguish.
Oh,
That distinction. There are a lot of sideline white.
And even the productive whites of today are not of the same quality, necessarily.
No.
Of the ones who actually really did build the country. So we got to...
This is true.
It's a mess.
Because you have a lot of blacks running around saying, we built this country. Well, I don't think you drew up the drawings to create any of the buildings.
Right.
You did the labor, but you didn't create it.
Yep.
You know, just because you work at Walmart doesn't mean you built the empire. You know, so it's all semantics.
Yeah, so true.
So, anyway.
Great call, man.
I don't want to take up too much of your time, but I just wanted to get that off my chest, Hank.
Thank you, Al. Great call, man.
All right.
Take care.
No problem.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
I appreciate Al's calls. So take heed, judgmental whites, judgmental blacks, and others. The Hispanics, too. Nice. We're coming up to the top of the hour here. Before we get to Super Chats, before we get to the music... Let me do a super chat or two here, because I missed them yesterday. Over on buymeacoffee.com/thehakereport, yes, Gunner bought 3 coffees yesterday during my call with my co-hosting with Big Bump. Yes, Gunner 94, thank you for the 3 coffees, man. Appreciate the support. I've heard him call into American Anchor Baby, by the way. I counter-argue your opinion on college. I do agree that a communications degree, arts, English degree might be useless. On the other hand, economics, aviation, nursing degrees, engineering degrees are marketable for a good future, he says. You guys are so anti-education. By we guys, Hake, JLP, maybe some others. Communications, art, English degree. I got the art degree. economics degree. I don't know if I agree about the economics degree. Maybe it could be. Aviation. I hadn't heard of an aviation degree. That's cool. Nursing degrees. I've seen people go to school for nursing. Yeah, of course. You learn some good skills. Engineering degrees. Sure. Yeah, I'm for some of those things. Yes, Gunner 94. Even those, I argue, is in a world of communist liberal indoctrination. So be warned, even if you're getting a useful degree, you still are subjecting your ears to commie nonsense, okay? Just like Hake subjects your ears to Commie Nonsense Network and the ladies at the Skim, the far-left females. Even going to college, you'll be immersed in all that mess. Even going to math, STEM, science, engineering, technology, all that stuff. Even then, you're going to be involved in that. And a whole lot of this stuff that you can learn on YouTube or self-learn or whatever. I'm not anti-education for those things. I'm anti, and it's not even education that I'm against. I'm against this, because education is learning on your own. Homeschool. Learn by doing. The school of hard knocks, as some people on old Facebook used to call themselves what they went to. I went to the school of hard knocks, which is to say they just started working and did some dumb things and suffered for it. I guess, or their parents did wrong things, and so they're suffering more from it. So those things are education, too, in my estimation. Older is supposed to be wiser. You're supposed to become wiser. But, yeah, I'm against a lot of colleges and universities now, in general, for the most part. And, yeah, you're right. A lot of they're offering more and more and more of this useless stuff. And it's just pride. It's all you get is knowledge and this false sense of pride. So that's why I bash the edumamification. People get all mama and soft. The less educated people oftentimes are better able to retain their common sense. They don't lose their common sense. They're not so open-minded that their brain leaked out. And that is a hat tip to Steve Taylor. And it's Steve Taylor Tuesday, guys. This track is entitled Svengali from the 1987 album, I Predict 1990. I hope you enjoy it, you musical Philistines. You can go outside, shovel snow, plant your garden, harvest your crops, have it made in the shade, drink your lemonade. But I'll be right back for hour two. Hang tight.
Yeah.
so good. Deep in his den. He's wanting all he can get. Will your heart hold the virtue? You never know. I didn't know what this song was about. Still don't. The blimp. Well, thank you guys for bearing with me through the beautiful, you know, arguably okay music. Shout out to Steve Taylor. He's Christian, guys. I put Svengali pictures in the folder here just to show you, Hassan. Because I looked it up. I'm like, what's Svengali anyway? I thought that it was some desert in, like, the Middle East or somewhere. But, it's a fictional character, and there is a guy who's, like, wide-eyed, mesmerizing, John Barrymore, something, it's like a, Svengali is a stereotypical anti-Semitic portrayal of an Ashkenazic Eastern European Jew, complete with bold, black, beady Jew's eyes. What? Also a character in the novel Trilby, first published in 1894 by George du Maurier. Maurier. Svengali is a Jewish man who seduces, dominates, and exploits Trilby, a young half-Irish girl, and makes her into a famous singer. Whoa. So, I still don't know what the song is really about, but it's, you know, people get mesmerized by sin and evil and stuff like that. The devil. And one another. Other people in the world. Ooh, scary. Based, says Hassan. Steve Taylor. Whoa. I wonder if Steve Taylor is like a Jewish Christian. Anyway, thank you, Hassan. That's that. More super chats. I am remiss in not getting to all the super chats. Popcorn's Thump Keg accuses me buying a coffee, saying, you skipped my pithy optimized coffee this morning on JLP's show. What the? I did not skip it. You missed it, but I did not skip it. I read it. Hopefully you put me in the front of the queue tomorrow, smiley face emoji. No, check it out. I covered it. That we did super chats multiple times, probably at the end of hour one and during hour two of the Jesse Lee Peterson show. So you can go back and check it out. You can check the Hake News notes in the hakereport.com/news. Let me see if I have that as a reply command. Oops. Let's see. Hake News, not fake news, from the JLP show, thehakereport.com/news. And you can see, I try to take notes on the Jesse Lee Peterson show, and I note when super chats happen during the course of the different hours. So, yeah, I didn't skip it. It's amazing to me that Trump picking Larry Elder would be kissing up, in your opinion. How? Disqualify Elder on his merits, character, etc., not his color. Anything else shows that you don't believe that it's not about color slash race thing. Not true, man. Because we're living in a culture of, we are living in this, immersed in this affirmative action culture. Oh my gosh. Ugh. Rubbing my, whatever this thing is when you have a headache. I'm so sick of this kissing up to the black stuff. I read this article, or I didn't read it, but I caught portions of this article. I have my Flat Earth Society thing here. about LeBron James. LeBron James. And this guy's got an affirmative action business. Toyota, I think, hired one of his companies to make a Black History Month little short, you know, for social media, short or reel, whatever, short video, promoting the importance of HBCUs. Toyota, you know, the car company, Japanese car company that has factories in the United States and in Mexico, maybe. Toyota, a car company, advertising historically Black colleges and universities. That is called kiss-up culture, affirmative action, de facto, permeating the culture. And I'm not mad at LeBron James for getting that bag, taking advantage of the culture that's kissing up to Blacks. Hey, you want to, might as well pay me if you're going to pay somebody to go kiss up to Black colleges. Give me a break. I was thinking about how Joe from Phoenix brought up to JLP, one of my callers, also called JLP, that saying that white enrollment is up at historically Black colleges and universities. Like, I don't know if that's supposed to mean that Black colleges and universities are becoming more reputable or something, but edumamification in general, as Yes Gunner pointed out, is becoming more and more dishonorable. Useless. People are getting out of college. It's been happening for maybe decades now, and not having jobs, because partly because their degrees are useless, and partly because their degrees are useful. But we have this unfettered immigration thing. We have all kinds of mess going on. We have what is that stuff called that we should get rid of? Minimum wage. Unnecessary. A whole lot of onerous, unnecessary, and activist regulation. It's evil. So, yeah, we have... I'm not for that mess. And, yeah, Elder is... He's untested in terms of that stuff. Seemingly, in my opinion. I don't know what he's led. If you can show stuff that he's led and run and built, I know he's successful, and he's been successful for a long time. That's cool. He's smart, very knowledgeable, and he's about the family. But in terms of running the show, I don't know. I don't know. So yeah, and he is Black, and that's just... That's a sticking point for people. So we should just... No more time for you guys. No more time for you guys. Shout out to the Blacks. Joe in Phoenix, Arizona is on the line. How you doing, Joe? Are you there?
I'm doing well, James. Yes, how are you?
I'm doing fine, too. Thank you.
All right. A couple things. You were probably thinking about the Serengeti Desert in Tanzania.
Yeah, probably. Serengeti. Svengali, Serengeti.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right. I'll get to the affirmative action here in a second, but yesterday Big Bump was talking about, you know, Black people decrying acting white, right? And listen, I've been called an Oreo my entire life.
Yeah.
By certain Black people who find it threatening when you are educated, when you are intelligent, when you do the right things. I mean, as I told you before, I've never had a drop of alcohol in my life. And you wouldn't believe the, I'll call it abuse, I guess. I took in high school and college from teammates and friends who called me a goody-goody and trying to be white and all that other nonsense. You just have to be strong and ignore it all, that's all. And I don't know if you've ever seen a movie called Glory.
I've heard of it.
The first Black regiment in the Civil War. Fantastic movie. So this dates back to slavery times. Denzel Washington played a runaway slave who joined the regiment, who had been beaten and whipped and all that, and he had a lot of anger and hatred towards white people. And Andre Brower portrayed a free Black man in the same regiment, who had grown up in a white household, basically, and had gotten educated and spoke very well and was very smart and intelligent and was teaching the other slave troops to how to read. And Denzel Washington's character attacked, you know, verbally attacked Andre Brower's character. What were you trying to be, white, Snowball, right? All that kind of stuff. And
yeah.
Just because.
Is that factual that during the Civil War times, the blacks were talking like that to one another?
I can't. I can't definitively say so, but I wouldn't be surprised.
Right. Yeah, because human nature is either playful or viciously teasing and pointing out the differences in the races. And so, yeah, of course.
But again, it goes back to feelings of jealousy and inadequacy between, you know, about people who aren't doing the right things and never been taught to do the right things. That's all.
Yeah.
Or expected to or held to a standard. I was fortunate that I come from a family full of educators and expected me to do certain things and demanded me to do certain things. I had a father who didn't take in any guff at all. And, you know, I was never going to disappoint him in anything.
Yeah.
So I was fortunate about that.
Nice.
Now, affirmative action. James, I told you before, white women are the biggest beneficiaries of affirmative action, not people of color.
So we should get rid of it entirely because we don't want white women going to school and all that stuff necessarily, right?
Well, Title IX disagrees with you for sure on that. But
yeah, get rid of Title IX. I abolish Title IX because these anti-discrimination laws and these affirmative action stuff. I'm not for any of that, as you know, because.
But it drives me crazy that folks think affirmative action, oh, it's for those darn blacks and colors and all. No.
It does help them,
far
too.
More.
It helps women more because there's so many more women, white women.
Well, there you go.
So it's not really more per capita.
With white women now. Oh, no, it is. It is. They study from Texas A&M, Harvard, Howard.
But yeah, I don't even think that you really understand what per capita even means.
Oh, yes,
because you've confused it in the past. And I know you're smart and educated. You're intellectually smart and educated in the edumamificated, I mean.
Yeah, okay.
Because we've argued about other things, and then you said, oh, like you showed me that you didn't know what per capita meant. So you kind of confuse me sometimes.
Nope, you're wrong about that, James. But
do you happen to know the relative rate per capita that women... that white women get affirmative action as opposed to blacks getting affirmative action?
I have not. The article I read was from the Department of Labor also.
Maybe that's because...
They didn't go into the details of the numbers, but they did say that women are by far the biggest beneficiaries.
Biggest beneficiaries is just most numbers. So that doesn't say anything about per capita.
I don't know.
Yeah. So then per capita, you just made a claim you didn't necessarily know.
No, I just quoted to you from the Department of Labor and sources, and you're just trying to stir it around.
I'm not trying to stir it around. I'm trying to get some clarity because the Department of Labor didn't say per capita, according to you, at least not that you read.
Correct.
Yeah. So per capita, we don't know who's benefiting the most necessarily.
Okay.
Right.
But I can't say that per capita,
yeah.
White people get the biggest, are on government assistance more than any other group.
That's not per capita, man. You're misusing the term per capita.
See, you don't understand. Per capita, they are, James. Yes, 100%. When you add in Medicaid and food stamps, it's the white people who are per capita, and I know exactly what that means, getting the most government assistance. Period.
You've been wrong about a lot of this stuff, and some of it is lies, and some of it is perhaps honest mistake, or maybe just a stubborn.
As you like. I'm the only one getting sources. And you don't like it. You say, oh, you're lying or you're wrong, Jay. Nope, you're wrong, Jay.
Well, you may get sources, but you're misapplying what's going on and all kinds of stuff. Are you like prideful about anything? Are you slowed down at all and frustrated? Like, what's going on?
I have no idea what you're even referencing.
So, When you get something wrong and I correct the record on it, are you able to be like, okay, I stand corrected on that?
I'm able to do that, but you've never done that with me. And
I have done that with you, though.
you never have.
And then sometimes you play, you say, oh, you didn't understand what I was saying. I was
wrong.
Talking about...
Never done that.
Yeah, you say you didn't understand what I was saying because I'm talking about this is going to feed it. For example, the civil versus criminal. This is going to feed into criminal. So I don't know if it's because... Because you know you had that...
On that one.
You had that...
I was trying to get to the Alvin Bragg case and you wouldn't let me. You were focused just on the Letitia James case, but you wouldn't let me finish. So you confused that I was getting it wrong and I wasn't.
Okay, but you misstate stuff, and you also falsely say that when I say a factual statement, you think that I'm saying something that I'm not saying.
You rarely say factual statements, James.
You think I'm saying something that I'm not saying, and you say no, and then you get all particular and it's in like an attempt to kind of downplay the black violent crime or whatever. And
you mean factual. I've never ever downplayed black violent crime. I've always said it's terrible and awful and it needs to be addressed.
Right, but you also say that it's a tiny, tiny percentage when I don't also say that it's a tiny, tiny percentage in my statement that it's out of control, then you call it a lie or something like that. And it's not a lie. So it's
100% a lie.
After you had mentioned years ago that you had this stroke, does it affect your mind, your clarity, and do you get frustrated with that? I'm curious.
You know, I noticed that I would get more easily frustrated before I had stem cell procedure, which was incredibly painful and expensive, but it helped a great deal.
Stem cell procedure?
Yes, my mind is not cloudy. I don't forget things, and I don't misunderstand things, James. I just hold you accountable, and you don't like that.
Now, no, I'm fine with accurate stuff, but a lot of this stuff is nitpicky, not accurate.
It's not nitpicky. It's just factual, and you don't like it, which is why you try to downplay it or wave it away.
But you don't like my alternative facts. You don't like the big picture truth.
There's no such things as alternative facts.
Yeah, there are.
There are facts, and then there are.
Are there such a thing as cherry picked facts?
Cherry picked, sure.
Yes. So there are such a thing as alternative facts because the media is selective about the facts that they present, and intellectuals, academics like you are.
Good point.
Yeah, and you too. You too. Hang on. You hang on this less than 1.05% or whatever of blacks commit violent crime in a year. And that's and you want to say those are the facts, but that's not the facts. That's one fact, maybe, I don't even know if it's
James,
true.
Yep.
And it's then there's other true. Facts that
and I,
give.
And I do that, James, because.
And then there's other
like
facts.
And the chat
if, can
are
I speak?
Shocked by that
can
fact,
I speak?
When I do that.
I'm not shocked by it. Can I speak? And then there's other facts that give a big picture of how people that gives credence to how people are. It gives an understanding to how people behave and act around blacks and are suspicious of them or risk or protect themselves around blacks.
Good point. That brings me to my next point.
All right.
You've never had your life put in danger. I have, James. I told you the story how I was once pulled over in front of a golf course. I was driving a little bit too fast, about 10 miles an hour over the speed limit.
Ooh.
The cop that came up to me. Yeah, that's fine. I pulled over and I gave him all my stuff, but he was so unbelievably nervous and jittery. He unsnapped his holster while walking up to my car door there. And was just, I mean, he was palpable. The guy was just freaked out. Again, I was in a rural area, so there wasn't, I'm guessing he didn't see many black folks there, but you know, I had a white friend just sitting next to me. And I gave him all my stuff. He went back to his vehicle. To his car. I'm sure he was running my plate and saw that I have no record or no nothing, right? It was just a simple speeding ticket, and that's fine. Now, my white friend had his cell phone in my armrest, you know?
Uh-huh.
And the phone rang when the cop went back to his car. And my friend stupidly reached into the armrest. I'm like, Dave, get your hand out of there. That cop is freaking out back there seeing you. The cop jerked his head up and went for his gun when my buddy went in the armrest to get his phone. Now he didn't understand that the cop was so freaked out just because I'm assuming because I was black, I guess. I don't know why, but I'm assuming that. But my life should not be put in danger, James, just because of a simple speeding ticket. That's why I get upset and I, I try to hold you and Jesse accountable for spreading those false narratives about most black people.
I don't spread any false narratives about most black people, and nor does Jesse.
Well, I think we disagree on that.
Yeah. So you're just...
Most black,
your fear
most
is...
Most black people are not...
Your fear...
Evil.
We're not going to go over that again. Your fear is every bit as evil as that cop's alleged fear that you're telling me about. And it's every bit as dangerous and destructive. You want to let go of that rather than harp on it and attack people who are part of the solution, especially JLP.
You know, James, it goes back to what I told you about Full Metal Jacket, winning of hearts and minds. Jesse does none of that. Insulting, denigrating, and stereotyping most black people on a daily basis does not win hearts and minds.
Well, we disagree on that because every week in church and every day on the Jason Lee Peterson show, blacks, whites, Hispanics, foreigners, and everybody else are calling into JLP their hearts and minds won back to the Lord. So thank you, Joe and Phoenix, for your concern.
All right, well, we disagree,
Mama.
But that's where I am. Yeah.
All right.
Get your jobs in, James. Got to get your jobs in.
It's true.
Not true. That's your opinion, but it's not true at all. But have a good day, James.
You too. What a fun call. Being a cop in the U.S. sounds scarier than being a soldier in the Middle East, says Greenwall. Indeed. I got to get to Ronnie in Ohio on the line here. Ronnie, thanks for calling, man. What's up?
My brother James, what's going on?
Not much. How about you?
I can't call it. I'm still on saying that Nikki Haley's Trump's best choice for VP.
Oof. Don't say that out loud again, man.
I'm telling you.
About to question your masculinity.
As an impartial third party,
yeah,
I think Nikki Haley's his best bet.
You're not impartial,
don't
man.
Want, and if,
go ahead.
And if people don't want her to run in 2028, she'll at least have a track record as being VP. But I don't see anybody else that fit. But I'm not mad at the Larry Elder pick. I don't know why you are.
I'm not mad at it, but I don't think that he's the one. And I really admire him. He's better. He's a better fit than I would be at this point. But this guy, he's untested, and I'm baffled that you think that Nikki Haley would be. I'm just really distracted by that. I forgot that you'd said that. Had you said that on my show before?
Yes. Once the debate kind of sparked, or so-called debate, I guess. Once it sparked, I was like, "Nah, Nikki Haley's the clear best fit." She probably
why are
won't
you
be
such
the choice.
Why are you such a pro establishment guy? Like you,
it's not even it's not establishment. It's her track record. You said Larry Elder's not tested,
right?
How could he be tested in a way that Nikki Haley hasn't been tested?
Nikki Haley has been found wanting. She's tested and failed.
How can Larry Elder be tested in a way that Nikki Haley hasn't been tested?
I don't know what I don't understand the question.
Okay, so you said Larry Elder's not tested.
Right.
So that means that there are gaps on his resume.
Yeah, I don't know that he's run an empire or built an empire exactly, you know? In the way that Trump did.
That's the prerequisite for running for vice president.
Yeah, you can. I mean, because he could become president. What's that?
Mike Pence didn't do those things.
Yeah, and I didn't know Mike Pence. I wasn't either for or against Pence.
Okay, so I guess
at the time.
My question for you would be, who are you for?
Azzmador.
If you're not for Larry Elder and you think Nikki Haley is
Azzmador, but in Azzmador and Larry Elder's defense, I don't know that either of them have built empires, but Azzmador is at least a white Christian man who's loyal, and Elder is a black Christian man who's pretty seems loyal, but Azzmador is just the man for the job. But I don't think that's going to happen anyway. It's not his time. I don't think it's even his time really. But there's nobody I really like.
Got it.
Yeah, but Nikki Haley, come on. She's been found wanting. She caved on the beautiful rebel flag on the Capitol grounds of South Carolina, wherever she was governor, one of the Carolinas. She called Trump racist or dumb or something like that back in 2016. He put her as ambassador to the UN, got her out of the country, thankfully. I don't know if that's what that means. And then she came back and is attacking Trump again and being a phony politician and warmongering, just like your other hero, John McCain, another rhino who didn't belong in the government. And that's why I call you so establishment friendly, because you have this idea of acting with civility and being all statesmanly or something like that.
Treating people like human beings?
Trump, that's what Trump does. He's the only one who does it.
Get the hell out of here.
Get the HB double toothpicks out of here? Is that what you said?
Get the hell out of here.
Hey, 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 kids listen to the show.
With respect.
Heck. Go ahead, go ahead.
I said what I said.
Yeah, yeah. He's laughing at me. He black.
Yeah, Trump is not, character-wise, I'm
great
not saying
character.
He needs to change or anything,
yeah.
But if you're accepting of the, I call it baggage, if you're accepting of the baggage or the circus that comes along with Trump, you can't treat other people harshly. You got to keep them on the same, you can't expect more from Nikki Haley than you do from Trump if you want Trump to be the president again.
I will never expect more from Nikki Haley than I would of Trump, because Trump has shown himself to be part of the light of the world, as Jesus called his disciples. And Nikki
so
Haley
hold
is
her
darkness.
To a higher standard? Why hold her to a higher standard?
I'm holding her to a low.
Her calling
I'm holding.
Names.
I want some semblance of loyalty from her. She has none. She's a kiss up to the fake racism thing. She's a kiss up to the fake woman thing. She's a kiss up to warmongering, I hear. She's a phony rhino, phony politician. And she's a woman. She's not fit to lead. And
oh,
she's
shame on her for being a shame on her for being a woman.
No, not shame on her for being a woman, but shame on her for trying
good,
to be the president.
You just told me kids listen to the show and you're writing her off because she's a female. And you're
right.
Writing off Larry Elder because he's black.
I don't write him off because he's, well, I write him off because he's black for vice president because it feels like kiss-up stuff.
So Trump should choose somebody because they're not black?
Yes. He should pick a white. Because that would be great. We're all about symbols in America. Symbolic is important. Symbolism is important. We need to be shamelessly all white in our leadership. Because the liberals have gone so far with this diversity crap, sorry kids, parents, that we need to be the opposite extreme. White, men, rich, Christian. You know what I mean? Wouldn't that be fun? In your face type of thing? Wouldn't that be lovely? And we love the blacks, and there's some quality blacks who could become great leaders, like, you know, Clarence Thomas. JLP, Larry Elder could do his thing around here somewhere.
So you apologize for saying rap cray.
Yeah.
Rap K.
Yeah, app cray.
You don't apologize for it. You ever seen the movie Higher Learning?
I don't think so. Is that's like a 90s one that has like rap, maybe rap, but like hard rock and stuff like that, I think.
It's movie? It's about a bunch of college freshmen. And
okay.
How there's the cultural clash. You got
I think I have
different
the,
backgrounds.
I've never seen it, but I think I might have the soundtrack of all things.
Yeah. But,
yeah, I have Depeche Mode, Otis Redding, Tori Amos, Outkast, Rage Against the Machine. Higher Learning.
Hold on,
music from the motion picture. Tori Amos covered Losing My Religion originally by R.E.M., right? I think. And Outkast had the song Phobia. Rage Against the Machine had Year of the Boomerang. But no,
yeah,
I've never
sure
seen it. Go ahead.
Yeah, I was going to say, I know the soundtrack's probably diverse, but
yeah.
It's good. It's there's racial tension in the movie.
Okay.
And it's based on incendiary comments from people saying things like white power.
Oh, okay.
So to say that the president or the hopeful president for you should pick somebody else because they're white and they should carry that on, it's, when you say something like that to impressionable teenagers, they might take it the wrong way, whether they're black or white.
Oh, don't be mama about them, man. I encourage you not to worry about the kids. They'll be just fine.
I'm not saying I'm worried about them. What I'm saying is if we need to watch, if we need to say heck instead of hell, we need to also make sure we're not saying things that are miseducating them into thinking that race does matter.
No, we're not.
It matters on, and it should be somebody white, and we need to carry on white things, and that in the third.
It matters on earth.
Like race matters.
It matters on earth, but it doesn't matter spiritually.
So then, in that case, to me, if I'm a teenager, I'm going to get more of a message from you saying Trump should pick a vice president that has a good spirit, as opposed to somebody that's white and not black.
It should be a good-spirited white man. Man, white man.
Good Lord.
Wouldn't that be awesome, though? Aren't you, like, rolling your eyes at all of this? Oh, the first black this. Ooh, we made history. Don't you roll your eyes at that kiss-up stuff?
Depending on the context. If it's, obviously, if it's something that's groundbreaking, like the first black president or the first black vice president, go ahead, but it's not something that should be mentioned repetitively over and over and over again.
Yeah, and even the first black president and black vice president, that's an eye roll too, especially since they picked such horrible ones. Obama and this, I guess she's black, right? Kamala Harris. Those are the worst ones that you could imagine. She's not even a normal black. Nor is Obama a normal black American.
Right.
And nor are they even, we don't have and worst of all, they have the worst morality.
I don't know if I want to go down that rabbit hole with you. Actually, I don't want to go down that rabbit hole with you, but
pro-LGBT, pushing the racism thing. Go ahead.
Unfortunately, Obama's the best black president we ever had because he's the only black president we ever had. So if this is the great melting pot and the land of the free and the home of the brave, you think it'll be more historic representation, but that's where we are.
No, man, you don't want representation. Representatives are for, representation is shallow.
That is golden coming from the mouth of a white man who probably hasn't. Have you ever been like the only white person in the room?
Yeah.
And you've noticed that, right? Like you understood you was the only white person in the room, right?
When I see a mirror, I'm like, whoa, white. Forgot.
Good Lord. So my point is, there's the opposite inverse of that, where you have black people who are always, sometimes the only black person in the room.
So what?
There's a difference in understanding it. So when you say who needs representation, or you say who cares that all the presidents except one were black and all the
one was one of the worst of all the presidents.
How could he have been the worst if he's
the worst in our lifetimes?
You crazy. The way he walked into that office when it was a mess, and then he left it a beautiful setup for Donald Trump to come in.
Are you kidding me?
You crazy.
That's not crazy.
No, I'm not kidding you. Look at how things were in 2008, and look at how things were in 2016.
Much worse in 2016.
You are crazy if you think that.
Ever heard of Black Lives Matter?
On any scale.
Ever heard of,
on any scale were things worse in 2016?
Ever heard of Black Lives Matter?
That's not Obama's fault.
Yes, it is.
Did he start the organization?
He supported him.
Did he start the organization?
Nope.
So then how is it his fault?
He supported them. He brought them to the White House. He validated their false narrative of this imaginary racism thing based on pure speculation. What a snake in the grass.
People aren't validated just because they go to the White House.
No, he validated. Not just because he brought them to the White House. Everything that he said on these issues, these famous Black Lives Matter incidents, Trayvon Martin, Mike Brown, and all these other things, Freddie Gray and all that. All that kissing up to the fake idea, I've been followed in department stores and many. Practically every black man in America has been followed in department stores and stuff like that. What a phony. A snake in the grass. An evil person. A divider. We're worse off in 2016 than 2008.
I strongly disagree. I don't know what circles you were running in.
No, you're just blind on this issue, man.
I'm not.
Yeah, you think Nikki Haley's a good presidential pick.
When Obama left, it was 75 straight months of added jobs. Donald Trump ended that streak, but every single month was getting better and better and better.
You think Obama helped with the job situation?
I'm telling you, 2016 was better than 2008.
No. Do you think Obama helped with the job situation? Yes or no?
I think that 2016 was better than 2008.
So you can't admit that Obama did not help with the job situation?
Go look at unemployment.
You don't want to say yes.
Look at the unemployment number from your statistics guy. Look at the unemployment
numbers. I'm not a statistics guy. I'm a truth guy. Everybody's a truth guy, right? But I'm a look at the man guy. It was the slowest recovery of the recession, everybody was saying, ever, because he was dragging it down with all this mess.
It was a recovery.
It was not a recovery.
People were complaining that it didn't happen fast enough. So Republicans drove the bus into a ditch and then said Obama took too long
you
to get it
back on
the road.
You're so phony, man. You're falling for all this mess.
2016 was better than 2008.
No,
and
it wasn't.
When I say Republicans did it's because they had the House, the Senate, and the White House in 2008.
This is so phony. You're basically falling for the establishment because Republicans are just as bad as Democrats in terms of being dumb liberals.
Wait a minute. Which establishment do you think I support?
You support the John McCain, Nikki Haley establishment, an Obama establishment, apparently.
Well, first of all, those are really three different, I guess, establishments.
No, they're not. They're all the same. They're all kissing up to one another, and especially one towards the Obama side. Because the so-called Republicans...
You're either on Trump's team or you're... If in your eyes there's two teams, you're either Team Trump or your Team Anti-America, then you're right. But that's very divisive. And that's not uniting the races with truth.
It is the truth. There's good versus evil.
If you think
Obama was evil,
sides,
Nikki Haley's and evil, John McCain was evil.
If you think that there are only two sides and Donald Trump is the determining factor on which side you're on.
I didn't say that. I said Trump is,
you didn't have to say it.
Trump is a Christian, the light of the world.
It.
Aren't you a Christian?
You think that the only two teams are Trump supporters and people that are anti-Trump?
No.
You think those are the only two sides?
No, I said there's good versus evil.
So then how can Obama and Nikki Haley be from the same camp?
Because they're both children of Satan. They both believe in the racism thing. They both prop up women falsely. They both support tearing down the beautiful Confederate rebel flag of America. Stuff like that. They're snakes, serpents, children of the devil. And you fell for them. Yeah. Oh, my goodness. Now, Ronnie, come on, man.
Look at the numbers in 2008 and 2016.
Numbers
and
don't
you can
matter.
Compare them. I got to jump.
All right. Take care, Ronnie. Appreciate
Good
you, man.
Good talking to you.
Bye.
All right.
Alex in California is on the line. Alex, what's up, man?
Hey, Kupu, I'm going to zip through this short okay. speech, just like I always do, okay?
Okay.
All right.
He called me Hey, Kupu?
Hey, Kupu. Hey, Kupu.
You're lucky
right,
I can't reach
Phoenix,
you to
I'm
hit you,
because
I have a knockout punch. Go ahead.
I know exactly why Joe's angry. Joe is angry because he's mixed, so he's not black enough for the blacks, and he's too black for the whites. I think that's why he may not even know that, but I think I'm pretty sure that's why he's so angry.
That makes a lot. That's not why he's angry, but that's the that he's caught hell from both sides, and he has hell inside of him from his mama or whoever raised him. And maybe he pretends like he really respects his father, but it was more like a fear. I don't know if he really loves his father. And that's why he doesn't really love JLP.
Like I used
Great
to kind
point,
of disagree with you about the interracial stuff, but I'm starting to see the light, especially with people like Joe, because when you have someone who's a mixed race, they don't have the quote-unquote loyalty to one or the other.
Yeah.
And they're not, like I said, he's not black enough for blacks, and he's too black for whites.
Great point, man.
Point that he's going on about why white people are clutching their pearls around blacks and all that. He said something about getting pulled over and the cop like unholstered his gun and
yeah.
Well, I actually had a black person pull a gun on me. They didn't just unholster it. He pointed at my face, and he pointed at my face because we wouldn't open for breakfast a half an hour early.
Whoa.
So, Joe, if you want to talk about, like, how none of them commit crime or it's only 0.001, whatever it was.
I think it's 0.87%.
Really change anyone's mind.
Yeah.
You know, I've experienced it firsthand.
Yeah.
But I guess just to end it with.
Wait, so that was a black guy who pointed a gun at you because you wouldn't open a restaurant early?
We opened a restaurant at 7 o'clock. He showed up at 6:30 harassing the female cook, calling her the B word and
wow. All
sorts of stuff.
And this
I
is
told
a black
him,
guy.
Hey, dude, I was like, we're not open until 7.
Yeah.
Like, shut it down. Leave her alone. And he pulled out a gun, pointed it straight at my face. He didn't just unholster it, Joe.
Are you black or white or Hispanic or white, if you don't mind doxing your race or
me, ethnicity? I'm as white as paper.
Okay.
Yeah, you can't get whiter than I am.
Cool, man.
What was the point? So I wanted to end it
Alex
on
Alex Trump
a
VP 2024. Go ahead.
A statement and a question. Statement being the way that Joe goes about denying crime and statistics and denying the reality that blacks are doing what they're doing. It's not changing anyone's mind. In fact, you're making it worse when you deny the bad things that they're doing. It just you're obviously covering up for them, and that's not going to change any white people's mind. So my question is, what can black people do to change the perception of the public of the negative stigma that black people have? What is the plan to change that? Is it just denying all the crime and then saying white people are racist? I don't think that works really well.
Yeah. He has this blind anger at JLP and this blind criticism of JLP for the way that JLP speaks, and JLP speaks in just general terms, and a general statement is not a false statement. And it may be imprecise, or there might be some inaccurate things that you can nitpick about, just like with Trump, but the big picture is the truth. And the solutions and the love are undeniable, except to a blind person who can't see. So
right, and I don't mean to start like caller drama and all that. I just had to address this because it's something I was thinking about the other day. Like, what can black people really do to change the world's view of them? You know? It's almost too late at this point.
Oh yeah, they can just become individuals again, as JLP says. Don't go with the crowd. Don't go with your thoughts.
Like, let's say when there's a mass shooting with a white person, do you, James, or do I ever go, oh, well, it's not all white people? Or do we just look at it, oh, that guy is nuts, you know, that's a bad person?
Well, nowadays they've poisoned the well so much that blacks are like, oh, look at all these violent whites, and so that evil defensive spirit can rise up in me sometimes. I'm like, temptation to try to argue with the devil. But no, you're right, it's whites have always not been for being evil like that. And we've
been quite
self-policing.
We don't identify with other whites because we're so diverse.
Right.
There's
we don't
so many different types of whites.
I know.
And that's an issue too. I don't have quote unquote loyalty, or I don't believe in loyalty from whites because there's so many different ones and 99% of them seem to be liberal lefties.
Yeah.
So I just stick to myself. When I see some crazy serial killer, you know, cutting someone's face off and eating their baby and it's white, I don't go, oh man, don't report on that. You know, only 0.05% of whites do that. I just look at that as a bad person.
Yeah.
So Joe, I would recommend you stop identifying with a color. Maybe try identifying with being a human being like the rest of us, and your life will maybe improve a little bit. And I'm going to say it again. You're not black enough for blacks, and you're too black for whites. And that's something you're going to have to chew on and think about.
Nice, man. Appreciate the call. Alex in California. Take care, man.
Have a great day, James.
You too. Bye. I don't know. I don't think I will be able to get to my flat earth topic today. My ball, obvious globe earth. So I put this up for nothing, guys. I don't think that I'll be able to get to some of these other things that I said that I would get to. Such as this gal. You know, the one who hates Trump, the black one from Atlanta area. Space is cool, but we'll just have to get to it tomorrow, I think, because we're coming to a close. Joel Friday is going to be coming up soon. Okay? I have some super chats to read. It is from C-on-C, Three Coffees. Can't think of anybody for VP. They might wake up one day and decide to betray him. Hank is loyal. Samson Hake. I call her Delilah because she asked me personal questions. Be Trump's VP. If they won't stop him first. No. No, I don't think so. But thank you for the vote of confidence, C-on-C. Popcorn's Thump Keg says, I think you're missing the point of Trump's tax case. The problem is you can't say, oh, my property is worth $100 million. It's not a tax case. It has nothing to do with taxes. When you're trying to get a loan on it, and then when it's time to pay taxes on the property, oh, it's worth $70 million. Crude example, but I think that's the basis for it. Why can't you? Are you sure? Do you know that? He keeps on saying we collected millions from China in tariffs. He still doesn't understand how tariffs work. It's the American companies that pay the tariffs on the imports. This is basic stuff. But businesses started producing here again. So yeah, don't worry about it. Lastly, again, Hake goes, yep, as the caller is saying the discrimination against blacks is in their head. Yep, it's true. Meanwhile, he knows the organization he works for wouldn't hire a black person with a black-sounding name. It's not because they're black, it's because they're into the blackness. Duh! My close and personal friend Jib Jab bought a coffee. Do you believe in Santa Claus? I've never heard you speak on this, I think. Yes. White Lion bought our coffee. Hake, look up and share your thoughts on Calorgy Plan and Synagogue of Satan. Thank you, man. Someone bought three coffees. Keep on doing what you do. La, la, la. Appreciate it, guys. Shout out to Taking Care of Business for the ice cream. It's so too with 555-555-565. Thank you, guys, for the support. I have 2 minutes for Rick in Hampton, Virginia. Rick in Hampton, Virginia. You have 2 minutes to go, man. Go for it.
Man, James, my brother, man, I was like to say, man, Fani Willis, she might as well go ahead and admit that she's wrong, because the more she deny it, the more information they find about her and the more embarrassing it is for her. Now they got the secret text now. Now, if you have an affair, just imagine what those texts may say, if you would.
I haven't paid any attention to this situation. Rick?
Yeah. Right now, the judge, they submitted the judge some texts from Nate. What's his name? Well, anyway, the male attorney. Well, her lover. They submitted some texts that was on his phone.
Oh.
And the judge have, so it's sealed. I guess they can't make it public.
Yeah.
But, they can give it to the judge sealed.
What causes you to be interested in this Fani Willis thing?
Well, it goes to prove that they use most blacks for destruction.
Yeah, that's true.
That's all I'm proving.
They're just shameless.
Yeah, and it's like,
so they'll go through with it, and they don't. And some of them will get in trouble because it's not slick, and they're a mess. Terrible.
And here's my thing, and the church be letting it come. Now I'm like, I would tell her this, hey, look, Fani Willis, if you don't mind, could you just keep your situation out right now? Just ask us to pray for you and don't discuss your situation.
I have a clip of her being a mess.
Right.
In a church. I want to play it. I don't know if JLP has played it, but interesting, man. I appreciate your call, Rick. I got to cut it short. Let's talk again.
I love you guys, man. Love y'all, brothers. Y'all be blessed.
All right. You as well. Bye. Guys, this has been the Hake Report. I got to end in time for Joel Friday TV. Latin A and Callie wanted to comment on Joe and also Nikki Haley. Lord have mercy. Ronnie. That's okay, Ronnie. Hey, we all got our blind spots, of course. Everybody's blind. But this is Shuby Taylor. It's Shuby Taylor Tuesday, Black History Month, Somewhere Over the Rainbow. I think this is version 2 from the album The Human Horn or something. Hope you enjoy it. Your musical Philistines, Joel Friday TV next. Bye.
And now for my 8th selection, Over the Rainbow.
So good.
Fled weasels up.
So nice.
Let's
In this nice. Is he speaking in tongues? Somewhere over the rainbow. Azzmador on Rumble. Under my reign as deportation czar, we will have big, beautiful deportations. We will deport like you've never seen. People will say, this is so good. Vice President Azzmador, we can't keep deporting. We're tired of deporting. Israeli NGOs will pay for it, and Mexico, and the UN. We will make the cartels buy back their fentanyl at a huge profit. Shuby Taylor, guys. Absolutely kosher records. Oh, I got a schedule to watch. How a Man Should Treat a Woman by Joel Friday next.
Okay, I hope you enjoyed the tunes that I've done by the two great artists. Let everything that have breath praise the Lord. Praise ye the Lord. I've given you maybe not what you want, but hopefully what you need. The end. Shuby Taylor.
Adios, America. Bye.